everybody doing tonight? Are you glad to be dry and in the house of the Lord? All right. You're probably wondering, what in the world is he doing? Is that legal, what he's putting up there on the stage? Yeah. All right. Tell you what, let's move this over a little bit so we don't block that. Thank you, Brother David. So, yeah, we're dry, hopefully, and we're in the house of the Lord, so we're doing good tonight, right? All right, so, man, first I just want to start off and do something a little different. I want to say thank you to a few people. We've had the privilege to be up here in the sanctuary this week. We're having a business conference, a live stream conference, and I've just kind of got to see firsthand what kind of goes on behind the scenes throughout the day, and I've seen some people that really just work their butts off behind the scenes. And it was just awesome. And today we were watching the part of the business class was on giving recognition, like giving shout outs to those people, making sure they know. And so God just put it on my heart to text two of them, Gabe and David. They're just working like crazy. So I sent them a message, and one was received. And the other one, I mean, I just told myself, look, man, I love you. You're an awesome guy. I really appreciate what you're doing. I think you're doing a great job. And man, I'm all for you. I just want you to know that. And he wrote me back and he said, I don't like that. You know who that was? I'll give you two choices, Gabe or David. Gabe. So, yeah, I made it a point tonight. I'm going to call him out. And so every time you see Gabe, I want you to tell him, Gabe, I love you. I appreciate you. You're doing an awesome job. So he's going to learn never to tell me I don't like that. He's going to learn to receive recognition and shout-outs because Gabe is awesome. He really did a great job for us today. And thank you, Brother David, for helping me with the... David got soaked moving this whiteboard over here from our office. And thank you for my beautiful bride to allow some plants to come from home. And, of course, our pastors who really take a lot of chances on people to get up here and speak to you. They have a lot of faith, let's say that, but they're allowing us room to walk in our purpose. So thank you. Let's start with prayer. How about that? All right. Father, thank you so much for tonight. Thank you for the opportunity, God, to be here in your house, to hear your word. And Lord, I just pray that you would give us a special grace tonight to hear what you have to say to us, to open our ears. God, whatever it is you want to say, we are yours. We just ask that you would have your way tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So tonight, one shout out I forgot. Daniel. Daniel is awesome at making these creative pictures. So he made this for us tonight, and so thank you, Daniel, for that. So that's the title, if you can see it there, is If You Continue, and the key word there is two letters, if you continue. And so I've really been in this vein for a while, and God's really been working on me and feeding me in this If You Continue message in this series. And so I'm just going to, hopefully it's not like a fire hydrant tonight, drinking from my fire hydrant, because I have so much to give you. So hopefully it'll come out clear, concise, palatable, and easy to take and apply to your life. So Pastor Bob told me, was it Monday? Monday morning prayer. Hey, shout out. Men have prayer here Monday mornings at 6 a.m. So we were here last Monday, and he said, you know, how I gauge a good message, how I can tell if a message was good, is if I still remember it a couple months down the road. And I was like, wow, that's good. I get that. I understand that. And then it made me think, okay, so what part of that is the responsibility of the speaker, and what part of that is the responsibility of the hearer? Because I realize it's not all the speaker, right? And then maybe it's seasonal. Maybe you could have a great word, but the word's not in season. So there's a lot of variables there. And so tonight I'm just praying, God, help me to do my part for you. Help me to speak clear, concise, great for you. And I want to encourage you to lean in. Just lean in. I wish I had a funny joke like Paige does to kind of get the, what do they call it, that chemical that's really good, endorphins in your brain, you know, and helps you become ready for learning. But I encourage you tonight, lean in to this message. So there's two foundational scriptures that I want to start with and build on. And these really have to do back tying in with the title, If You Continue. Because probably 6 months ago, I was really asking God, this is going to sound crazy, but I was asking God, am I a disciple? Am I your disciple? And that the enemy was really working on me and trying to bring doubt in that area, because I had read so many great and precious promises and words that were given to his disciples. And so now there becomes this conflict between, okay, I know the word of God, I know what he's saying, I can understand this, but there's this one hinge here, and that's the enemy's just trying to work that one word in there, if you're a disciple, yeah, all this is true, if you are his disciple. And so thank God that he gives us his word that we can go and find out, we can dig and dig and dig and find out what his definition is of a disciple. Because at that point, I didn't know. I'm kind of ashamed to admit, I've been serving God for a long time. And at that point, I really didn't know. The enemy had really worked me over the coals to a point to where I didn't know if I was really his disciple. So I said, let's get in the word, let's dig, let's find out how God defines a disciple, how Jesus defines his disciples. So hopefully you'll see it there on the screen. John 8:31, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free, or set you free. You've all heard that scripture. But what I would ask you tonight, what is his basis for a disciple here? How does he clearly define what a disciple is? Hopefully you see there he's saying this one right here, this one word, if you continue in my word. That's his definition. And just to clarify that, we'll go a little further. Down in John 15:4, he's talking to his disciples again, and he says, abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. I'm the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Can anybody testify to that? Have you tried to do it on your own? For without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. Men gather them, cast them in the fire, they're burned. But if you abide in me, and here's the part what I want you to see, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall you be my disciples. So these are really the only two main defining principles that I could find for a disciple. So what's the first one? If you continue in my word. And what's the second one? If you bear much fruit. Well, can you see that they're connected? You're not going to bear any fruit if you're not connected to his word. The word is what's going to produce the fruit. So I really want to hone in on that tonight. And it sounds so simple, but trust me, it's not. Obviously, if it was simple, we'd all be producing miracles every day. We'd be having our needs met all the time. So there's something here that Jesus is really trying to communicate to his disciples. And so tonight, look, I'm going to give you everything I got. I've been watching Paige. I love Paige. A lot of great speakers we have. And so my heart tonight, I'm doing everything I can to help communicate this word and this principle in a way that you understand it, that you can take it and apply it in your life. So I'm using everything. I got the whiteboard. I got plants. I got my daily devotional. I got some pictures. I'm going to show you my closet. It's scary. I'm letting you into my life. I'm doing everything I can because that's my heart. And my passion is that when you leave here tonight, you'll remember this 2 months down the road, hopefully for the rest of your life, you'll remember this is how I walk this out. This is how I walk this out. So, okay, we know he's talking about the word, and I'm no artist, so please forgive my handwriting, but I realize that some people learn visually, and some people learn audibly, and some people learn, I call it OJT, they got to walk it out. They can't see it, they can't hear it, they've got to do it. So I'm going to try and give you as much as I can tonight. So when we're talking about the word, he's saying, if you continue in my word, what I want you to understand is that as a believer, let's make sure I can spell. I'm not used to writing all caps. You know how things look different when you spell them in all caps? No? Like, you ever looked at the word Wednesday in all caps? Wednesday. So there's two words that you and I have in our life from God. We have the corporate word, which is to all of us, right, corporately. And then we have the individual or the specific word. So is it safe to say that the corporate word is the Bible, right? That's the word of God for every single one of us, right? So that is for every single person here. Then we have an individual word. This may be in the form of a prophecy, a dream that you've had, a direct revelation that God's given you from reading in His Word, something very specific to you. This word is for the entire body of Christ. You can take these promises, you can take this word, and you can apply whatever it says. All Scripture is given for us, for reproof, rebuke, instruction. It's for every single one of us. This one, however, may not be for everybody because it's specific. It's for you as an individual. It's personal. It's personal. So what I want also for us to see is that this, hopefully, if you're coming to church, and thank you are, right? You're here on a Wednesday night. You're at least getting this once a week. You're continuing. Back to the title, if you continue. So I'm asking myself, how am I continuing in these two words that God's giving me, the corporate word and the individual word? Well, if you come to church at least once a week, you're going to continue in the word at least once. This, however, varies greatly. And the sad thing is that this one is very specific to you. This one is for your life. This one is for a season. Like, we all know we have a certain amount of time here on this earth, and we have a purpose that God's created us for. We have a job, a mission, something to do for the kingdom of God. We have some fruit that we need to be producing, and the clues to that are found most often in the individual word that God's given us. It's something that God has spoken to you individually. But what I find is that most of the time, we'll just go here by default. And we might read a little bit, you know, we might read a chapter or whatever, but we don't really spend a lot of time here. We might get the word, we might print it out. If we're really diligent, we might even put it on the wall or have it framed. But I would say that maybe a few months down the road, we kind of lose sight of this, you know? And so that's what I want to hone in on tonight, because the truth is, I've had a really battle here. This has been a real big battle for me, because the words that were spoken to me here were great. They were tremendous. They were, let's say, beyond me. They were so large that I knew it was truth because, you know, we have Prophet Ed that comes, right? And he'll read your mail. So you know that this is the truth. You know that no one else could know this. This is not Ed. This is the word of God to me. But most of the time, what he says is so much bigger than you, because it's God, right? He's either casting vision for the future. He's telling you what you need to do right now in your life. Maybe some friends you need to lose, some new things you need to take up, some character you need to develop, some godly character. It's greater than you. It's prophetic. It's in the future. It's something in the future to come. And so it's hard to see it in the here and now, and it's hard to be faithful with it. And so that's been my struggle. And so what I want to kind of clear up tonight is just maybe a few misnotions or misunderstandings. One, the big one for me is that God's word is infallible. It is His word. It is true all the way to the core. But His word is not guaranteed to come to pass in my life. That was a big misunderstanding for me. I thought if God said it, hey, it's done. It's going to come to pass. And there's nothing required on my part. And so that's where I really want to get tonight and to help you understand this. Let's drive this point home. First example I want to give you, if you've heard me preach, this is probably the one that changed my life, is the Israelites. The very first group of people that we come across in the Bible that God had a promise to them, a very specific promise for them. He promised them this land. But if you go back and you read the story, you find out that that first generation did not get to that land. So you see this great conflict between God's will. It was His will. He really wanted them to get there, but they didn't make it. And so it kind of tells, well, actually two did. Somebody help me out. Joshua and Caleb. Two did. So that see, I love that. There's some hope right there. There's some hope. That's that 2%er. That's somebody that was serious. They were, I know you're taking a motorcycle club, aren't you? But anyway, that's the hope that God gives us, that this is possible because two did it, Joshua and Caleb. And so there's a great example. How about when, let's bring it over to the New Testament, Matthew 17:19, We read where, now think about the context of this. Christ is here. The Messiah is here. The one who knows everything is here. And he has his disciples. He's teaching them. He's training them. He's instructing them. And they've seen this, no doubt, done before. Maybe they've even done it before. I don't know. But they come across this situation where they're trying to cast a demon out of a young boy, and they can't do it. Can't do it. Failure. Their fruit is not being produced. Let's say that. They've got a need, but they don't have the answer. The miracle's not working. It's not coming to pass. And so I love this. It shows their maybe it's their pride. I don't know, because they bring Jesus off to the side privately. They get him off to the side. After Jesus shows up, obviously you know the story, right? Jesus heals the boy. The miracle happens. But they come up to him off to the side, and they're like, Jesus, why? Why couldn't we do it? Why didn't it work? Like, we thought we knew. We thought we had it figured out. We've seen you do it. How are we missing it? And I don't like the answer. And maybe you won't like the answer. Because he said real clearly, it's because of your unbelief. But obviously they thought they believed, right? You don't do something. You don't try to do something unless you believe that you can do it. But he said, no, it's your unbelief. That's the issue. Okay, so this is another example of how you can see clearly it was God's will to heal this young boy. But in the beginning, we're seeing his will's not being done. So do you see the conflict there? Not being done, it's God's will, and over here it is being done. Let's drive it home a little more. Jesus in his hometown, Mark 6:5, it says, and he, Jesus, could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands on a few sick folk and he healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. It shocked him. He could not produce. Here is the king of the universe, and he can't produce a miracle for these people. It's his will. He's there. Why is he there in the first place? He's there to heal them. He's there to meet their need. He's there to provide for them, and he can't do it. And why is he marveling? Why is he shocked? Because of their unbelief. How about the Lord's Prayer? You all know the Lord's Prayer. Thy will be done in earth or on earth as it is in heaven. Why would we need to pray that if his will was automatically done? Why would we need to pray that and ask God that your will be done in this earth as it is in heaven if it was just guaranteed and automatic? 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us word, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So we know that it's not his will that any should perish. But can I ask you, don't you know some are going to perish? It's not his will, though, but some are. So I hope that establishes it for you, like once and for all, that here's God's will, and it's not always going to be done. Okay, there's a distance, there's a gap here that we've got to figure out how to solve this problem. So the greatest need that I see right now is very humbling for me to be appointed as an elder in this church. It's a huge weight to like be put in that position where you have to look out for other people, where you're responsible for other people, and you have to try and speak life into other people and guide them and direct them. It's a huge weight, because I know I'm going to have to give an answer for that one day. And so I don't take this lightly when I say that the greatest need that I see right now in our church, in the body of Christ, is for our needs to be met. It's to see God's word come to pass in our life. I almost feel like it's a miracle now if what we read and we read it and it comes to pass. It's like, oh my God, it was a miracle. Like a supernatural thing, like God came and sent an angel and touched somebody. But it shouldn't be that way. It shouldn't be that way. We should see more of God's will coming to pass in our life. So this hurts me. This is what drives me morning and night to get in my prayer closet and just pray and seek God, to study, to read the word, to find out where's the disconnect? Where are we missing it? Why aren't our needs being met? God said through Hosea the prophet, he said, my people are destroyed. They perish for lack of knowledge. It's a lack of knowledge. It's a lack of understanding. It's not that God's wrong or evil or bad, or he's too lazy. That's not the problem. It's a lack of knowledge. It's a lack of understanding. Back in Psalms 95, I was reading and it struck me to my core because God was expressing his grief and his anger with this generation, the first generation in Israel, the Israelites. And he says, for 40 long years, I was grieved with this generation. One translation says he loathed them. And he said, it's a people that err in their heart and they have not known my ways. It's not that he didn't try to get them to know his ways. They would not learn. Their hearts were too hard. And God loathed that. That just breaks my heart because I think, how could I be someone, how could I be loathed by God? That just the thought of that just wrecks me because I can't stand that. I've got to be, I'm his servant. I've got to figure this out. And so when he says that you've not known my ways, I said, okay, I've got to go figure out what he's talking about. He references Mirabah in there. So I go back, find in, I think it's like Numbers 20, whatever, where he's talking about the waters of Mirabah. And you all know the story where they're fed up, they don't have water, they're cursing God, they're saying they wish they would have been back in Egypt and they had died, all these things. And Moses gets frustrated and he goes to God and he's like, what am I going to do with these people? And God says, look, this time I want you to just speak to the rock. Don't hit it like we did before. Let's just speak to the rock. And you know the story, it's so heartbreaking that Moses goes and you could just feel his frustration and his anger because he knows God. He's walked with him, he's experienced him. And he stands there before the people and he gets infected by their unbelief. It rubs off on him, the one who's supposed to be leading these people. And he falls in this moment. He falls to their rebellion, their unbelief. And he strikes the rock. He's anger. And the water flows out. The miracle happened. The people got their need met. But God brings him to the side and he says, Moses, you messed up. You're not going to make it in. You disobeyed me. You didn't believe me. You disobeyed me because that was not his way. Nicole, hopefully you know that rock was a type and shadow of Christ. He's only struck once. Christ will not be struck again. This time he said, just speak to the rock. So then you read on further. That was in Numbers, I think, 20 and in Deuteronomy 30. If you follow Moses throughout the history there, in his very end, in his farewell address to the people, he stands before them and he lays out all these promises, all these precious promises and curses. He lays out both. But he says something very key that I don't want you to miss here because he's trying to communicate to the people. Deuteronomy 30, verse 11, he says, now what I'm commanding you today is not too difficult for you, and it's not beyond your reach. It's not up in heaven so that you would have to ask, well, who's going to go up to heaven and get it and proclaim it so that we may obey it? And it's not in the sea so that you would ask, who's going to go across the sea and get it and bring it back and proclaim it so that we may obey it? No, 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 no. Don't miss this. The word is very near you. It is in your mouth and it is in your heart so that you may obey it. See, today, I'm setting before you life and death, blessings and prosperity and curses. He's giving them the choice and the option, but he's saying, you choose. You choose. The choice is yours. God's spoken the word. God's given the blessing. God's given the seed to the sower. You choose what you're going to do with it. I hope this is helping you to understand there's a part we play in bringing this to pass. Than bringing God's word to pass in our life. And so I know you all have needs. I have needs. So I just kind of want to find a way to relate to you tonight and just ask you, what are your needs? Maybe you're sitting here saying, I'm not buying that. I'm good. I'm sitting here in an air-conditioned church. I'm not in the rain. I don't have any needs. But what about spiritually? Do you have any needs? Do you need humility? Please don't say no. The answer for all of us is yes. We're never not going to need more humility. Do we need grace? Do we need patience? Oh, I know you don't like that word. I don't. Patience. So we can agree there's something we all need spiritually. What about financially? Is there something you need? Is there something you're legitimately needing financially, but you don't know how to have your needs met? What about your health? Is there something in your health that's not right, and you don't know how to fix it? You've gone to the doctors. They've given you the best report, the best they know how to do, but your need's not being met. Spiritually, what about relationally? What about with your spouse or your children or at work, a coworker? Is there something that's just not right and it needs to be fixed, but you don't know how to fix it? I wrote down a lot of these. Relational, emotional, financial, spiritual, physical, work, wisdom. Does anybody need more wisdom? So hopefully there's something there you can find. There's a need there. You have a need here. I'm just going to tell you, if you don't know you got a need, you have a need. You have a need. I have a need. Somewhere here, we all have a need. So how do we get our need met? Well, let's go back. John 15:7. Jesus made it very clear. If you abide in me, could you say tonight that you're in Christ? Have you accepted him as your Lord and Savior? I think everybody here meets that qualification. If you haven't, please come talk to me afterwards. Let's get that right. But I think we could all say that we're in him. We're saved. But here's what he says after that. And my words abide in you. That word abide means stick. It means stay. That means, please forgive my terrible stick figure. But that means when you're walking around doing your day, the word's here. Actually, it should be here in your heart. The word should be hidden there. What did David say? Oh, Lord, I've hidden my word in your heart. I've hidden it. It's deep down in there so that I might not sin against you. I've hidden it, but I want to call you to honesty in this moment and say, if I walked up to you right now and I said, hey, yeah, there's your need. Okay, we got the need established, but what is the word of God? What is the promise to meet that need? And have you been diligent and faithful with it? Have you continued in that word? Have you sat down like God told Joshua day and night and meditated on it and meditated on it and let it change you and let it become who you are? Let it go from head knowledge to heart knowledge to the point where you wake up and you believe it. It's the first thing you think about. All throughout your day, you're speaking it. The Holy Spirit's bringing it back. You're remembering it. When you hear somebody say something contrary to it, you say, let God be true and every man a liar, because this is the truth. This is what I'm living. I'm breathing. I'm meditating. This word is coming alive in me. It's in me. It's abiding in me to the point where I start to say it and I'm not even trying to. It just comes out of me. I can't help it. That's how you know, because it says out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. People say things all the time. I can talk a good game. I can tell you I believe a lot of things. I can tell you that I know a lot of things in the Word of God. But until you get it in your heart, until it comes out automatically, it's just head knowledge. There's levels of belief. That's what Jesus was trying to say to them. Look, it's unbelief. Swallow your pride or spit it out, as the one guy came here and prayed. You don't believe on the level that you should. You may believe here, but not here, because you haven't continued. You haven't been faithful with the seed. So we see examples where we just talked about where these needs weren't met, and he said it's because of your unbelief. I don't want to focus on that anymore. I want to focus on the solution. Let's look at some real examples where people did get their need met, and let's see what happened. How about the woman with the issue of blood? Mark 5:25 says, now a certain woman had a flow of blood for 12 years, and she had suffered many things from many physicians. Spent all that she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. And when she heard, don't miss this, when she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd, touched his garment, for she said, not Jesus, remember, he's not even aware of what's happening. She said, if only I may touch his clothes, I shall be made well. And you know the story. Jesus was, he felt virtue leave him. And he turned around and he said, who touched me? And the disciples say, you're crazy. You're mad. The whole crowd is around you. Everybody's touching you. Why would you say, who touched me? He said, no, somebody touched me. Somebody got something from me. Something left my body. I want to know who it was. And I love what he says to her when he finally has this conversation with her. She was afraid for her life because she was unclean. And here she touched the Most High Priest. But her faith was so great that she was willing to risk her life. Are you willing to risk your life for the Word of God? She believed to that point. And he said, daughter, thy faith, your faith has made you whole. Go in peace and be free of that plague. Whose faith produced the miracle? How did she get her miracle? She heard and she said, you know the scripture, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. But I don't think she heard it one time. I think she had been waiting so long and crying out to God so long. I've got to have this need met. I've spent everything I have. The doctors aren't healing me. I've got to have this need met. So she had totally convinced herself that if I see him, they knew the Messiah was coming. They knew. But she had completely convinced herself that if I can just touch him, that's all I need. If I can just touch him, my need's going to be met. That was her level of faith right here. How about the centurion we read about who told the Lord, I don't even deserve that you come under my roof. His faith was so great. He said, Lord, just say the word. Just say it. Just speak it and it'll be done. And it says the Lord marveled. Jesus marveled. He said to them that followed, truly I say unto you, I haven't even found this great faith such as in Israel. Even with his own people. I haven't found this kind of faith because that man had convinced himself, if he just says the word, it's done. What did he say? I'm a man under authority. I know how this works. I recognize that you have all power and authority. You're the Son of God. If you say it, it's done. He made that connection because he was in authority. He lived it. He breathed it. He knew if I tell my servant to do this, it's as good as done. If not, he's dead. That's the way the Roman Empire worked back then. So he was so convinced in his heart that if this man who has all power and authority just says the word, it's done. Is that the level of your faith? How about Mark 5:22? It says, and behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet and he began to beseech him greatly, saying, my little daughter liveth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live. And Jesus went with him. Do you know that man was not going to leave until Jesus went with him? He had so convinced himself, if I can get him to come with me, she's going to be healed. My daughter's going to live. What about the blind man? Luke 18:35 says, it came to pass that as he was come nigh unto Jericho, a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitude pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him, it's Jesus of Nazareth. He cried, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they rebuked him. They told him to shut up. And he's began to cry all the louder. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. It got so loud and so bad to the point that Jesus stopped. And he said, we can't go any further. I've got to go see what this man's need is. But you see, he heard. He heard and he'd made up his mind right here. If he comes my way, I'm going to scream so loud, he's going to have to stop and come to talk to me. Jesus recognized that faith. He said, what shall I do unto you? And he said, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, receive your sight. Your faith has saved you. Whose faith was it? It was the man's. Immediately he received his sight, glorifying God and all the people. And when they saw it, they praised God. We don't even have time to go on the poor widow lady and the unjust judge. Avenge me of mine adversary. Avenge me of mine adversary. She's not going to give up. She's not going to quit. And the judge recognized that and he said, oh my God, this woman's going to wear me out. I don't even fear God. I don't fear man, but she's going to wear me out. She will not stop. So he met her need. He gave her justice. What about the parable of the man needing bread for his guest? Jesus said, because of his relentless persistence. Man, I love that. Relentless, not giving up. Relentless persistence. That's why this man got his bread. That's why he got his need met. The faith, the belief that he had to keep asking, he wasn't going to give up. This undivided, unwavering, unshakable faith. How do you get it? How? How did these people get it? Thank God for his word. Thank God that Jesus gives us the answer. Luke 13, 18. Jesus said unto them, what is the kingdom of God like? And what shall I resemble it? Because remember, the kingdom of God is spiritual. You can't see it. So he's trying to find a way to explain this in some natural way that they can get it. He said, it's like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took, cast in his garden. It grew and it waxed a great tree. The fowls of the air lodged in the branches of it. Luke 17, 5, the apostles said unto the Lord, increase our faith. What are you saying here tonight? Increase my faith. God, I need more faith. If I'm going to have my need met, I need more faith. And what does he say? Same answer. And the Lord said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you might say unto the sycamine tree, be thou plucked up by the root and be planted in the sea, and it should obey you. Matthew 13, 31, another parable he put forth, saying unto them, the kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed. He's saying the spiritual kingdom of God is like this seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. But when it is grown, it's the greatest among herbs, becomes a tree, and the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. Why did he have to keep saying this over and over and over? They didn't get it. They didn't get it. Matthew 17, 19. Remember when the disciples come and took him apart privately and said, Lord, why couldn't we produce the miracle? What's the problem? Why couldn't we do it? He said, because of your unbelief. That takes humility to say, okay, there's something here that I don't believe, because they thought they did. But he said, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you shall say, you know it. He's established this over and over and over. The answer doesn't change. But I think this is where we've missed it. We've missed it because, in fact, he says this. Matthew 13, when they come to him and they asked him, Lord, why? Why are you speaking in these parables? Why are you speaking in this crazy language? It's so hard for us to understand. Why can't you just speak to us plainly? Why are you talking in these parables? Have you ever read a parable and not understood it? Am I not the only one? That scares me because I know the answer. It used to scare me. Now I know it's just a matter of time. I have to spend time with this parable. I have to let the Lord reveal it to me. But listen, don't miss this. They asked him, why are you doing this? Why? And he said, listen, because it's been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them, it's not been given. It's a secret. Do you hear what he's saying? This is a mystery. This is a secret. And I'm not giving it to everybody. I'm giving it to you. And you're still not getting it. This is a mystery. This is a secret. And he's trying to give us a logical example of how it works. But what makes me so mad is for so long, I got hung up on the principle of the size. I thought it was the size of the seed. I thought, oh God, it's a, you know, you've all seen the picture of a mustard seed. It's tiny. Because if you go back and you study this out, you'll see some translations of the Bible that took the great liberty to put in their size. And go study it in the Greek and you'll find out size is nowhere in there. It's only the word as. As. They took that liberty upon themselves because they thought he was just talking about the size. But if you look up the word as and you go and study the root in the Strong's Dictionary, you'll find out he's saying in this manner, in this way, in this principle. This is the principle. Don't get hung up on the size. This is the way it works. It's as if a farmer should cast seed in his ground, in the soil. You know, I know you've heard this parable. What is the soil? The heart, right? This is our heart. But you know that only a small percentage of the seed gets here. Why? That's disheartening and encouraging at the same time. Because you know it's possible, but you know that there's a great challenge to get there. There's something I'm going to have to overcome. First off, I've got the enemy who's coming immediately to take it from me. And I guarantee when you walk out the door tonight, the same thing's going to happen. If I ask you next week, hey, what? No, I'm not even going to speak that. We're going to remember this. This is truth. This is life. But you know what I'm talking about, how he comes. Because someone asked you, what was the message about last week at church or Monday or Tuesday when you're at work? And what do you say? It was good. Paige did good, man. The door. I remember the door. It was about eternity. And catfish. You can remember catfish. Thank you, Gabe. But we forgot most of it. Why? Because we have an enemy of our soul who knows what could happen if you get that word. He knows the potential if you take what was given to you and use it to produce something in your life. Remember, what are the two definitions of a disciple of the Lord? Ask yourself that right now. And I'm not saying this to bring guilt or shame. I'm saying this to myself because I need to know the truth. I need somebody who loves me enough to tell me the truth. Don't babysit me. Don't patty cake me and tell me that, oh, maybe it wasn't God's will. It's His will. It's His word. The problem's here. I'm not doing my part. As I was preparing for this message, God was speaking it to me and He dropped it in me. He said, if you do your part, I'll do my part. And I started walking around my office and I started praying and screaming that out to God. Yes, if you'll do your part, I'll do my part. If you do your part, I'll do my part. That's what God was saying to me. This is my part. This is your part. This is the part we play in bringing the Word of God to pass in our life. Because I think what we're missing is the patience. I think what we're missing is the patience. Because we live in a microwave society where I can get everything I want just like that. We serve a crockpot God. Come on, you know that. We don't serve a microwave God. Listen to this scripture, Hebrews 6, 11 through 15. Says, and we desire that every one of you show the same diligence to the full assurance of the hope unto the end. He's talking about bringing something to pass. That ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience. It's a combination. Faith and patience inherit the promise. Here's the key. Faith is only half of it. Patience is the other half. We give up. Let's face it. We plant seed on day one. We go home and we say, oh, okay, I need this. I need this. And I'm going to do it. I'll be faithful for a day, maybe 2 days, maybe 3 days. But what happens a week later? Are we still in that word? Are we still meditating day and night? Are we still working on it, meditating on it, breathing it, living it? I told you how I had my greatest need ever met financially. I got so mad at the enemy stealing my word that I went at my wife. I stole my wife's whiteboard. You got to be desperate to steal your wife's whiteboard. I went in my closet. I screwed it to the wall. And I said, okay, God, here's the promise. Have a need, plant a seed. I knew the seed. I knew the word of God. But I knew humbly that down here at day 7, I wouldn't be in there. I would have lost it by day 7. So I told myself, okay, this is it. This is it. I'm not going to give up. I'm going to come in here morning and night, and I'm going to spend at least 5 to 10 minutes meditating on this word. And I debated on whether or not to show you this. I'm about out of time, but hopefully they've got some pictures. This was very... God's been working on me about false humility. I didn't want to show you this because I didn't want you to think that I'm anything special. I'm not. I'm not special. I don't know if they'll be able to put them on the screen. But this is what I do in my closet, in my prayer closet, morning and night. I sit here. I have a little stool. I've stole the kid's stool. I've stole the kid's stool. And I sit there in my closet. And I've got all these prophecies from the Word of God on my wall. And I sit there and I read over them and I meditate on them and I pull out nuggets and I dissect them and that word comes alive to me. It starts to mean more to me. It starts to go from here to here. And I'm telling you, I've seen the greatest miracles in my life. The reason why I'm standing here in front of you is because the word of God has changed me. I'm not the same guy I was a year ago in that closet. The word has renewed my mind and my heart. It's changed me. And I surround myself. You'd think I'm crazy if you come to my prayer closet because I have no more room left on my walls. I'm writing on the ceiling now. I've ran out of room. But I have to be in that environment. I know that this is where I need to be. And thank God I have a wife who doesn't pressure me. She knows that when her husband's in that closet, she gives me as much time as I need. Because when I come out, I'm not the same man. I'm a different guy. I've been transformed. I've been renewed by the Word of God. So she never pressures me. My kids don't even pressure me. In fact, they come in there and they try to take my time. And I tell them, get out. This is my time. You can write something on the wall, but this is my time with God. This is intentional. I know my time is short. I've been given a season. I've been put in this earth for a purpose. I can't miss it. I've got to bring the Word of God to pass in my life. I am not going to stand before Him and say, I didn't get it. I didn't understand it. You didn't give me enough instruction. There's no excuse. I've told you time and time again. He said it over and over again. This is how it works. But it's our job. We have to do it. It's hard. It sucks. It takes time. It takes diligence. It takes patience. But it's possible. I'm living proof. It's possible. I've seen the greatest miracles in my life come to pass. There's over 7,000 promises in the Word of God. There is one in there to meet your need. Go find it. Go get it. Go be faithful with it. Go sow it. Go water it with tears. David said, those that go forth sowing precious seed, weeping with tears, shall doubtless come again with sheaves of harvest, bearing precious harvest. You may have to water your seed with tears. But I'm telling you, God's word is faithful. It will come to pass. I want to read you. There's so many ways you can do this. You've heard Frieda talk about the index cards. You see the way I do it. I have to put it on my wall. I can't do it in traffic. It doesn't work for me. I have to be alone. I have to be in my closet. I have to be focused, because I'm telling you, as plainly as I can, there is a resistance to the Word of God in my heart. I feel it because it's so big. It's so great. It's such a precious promise that I feel resistance, even though I'm saying, I believe it. I'm a Christian. I love God's word. I believe this. Yes. But if I'm honest with you, there's some resistance there. And the more I spend time with it, the more I meditate on it, the more I dig into it, I feel that resistance leaving. I feel it letting up. And I feel myself getting to a place where I believe so convincingly that the person who is responsible for my miracle coming to pass tells me, no, I don't think that's going to happen. And it doesn't even faze me. The first thing that comes to my mind is, let God be true and every man a liar. Because I'm sticking with Him. I'm sticking with His word. My heart is built on that. I've done taking so much time. Do you know how hard it is to rip a giant tree out of the ground that's producing fruit versus this little seed that just got planted? Don't share your seed with somebody at this point. Unless it's somebody in your inner circle. Who was that, David, that talked on that? Don't do it. Go read the principle of Elizabeth when she was pregnant with John the Baptist. She waited till she was in her third trimester. She was a very wise woman. She knew that at this stage, if you try and share your seed, your promise with somebody, they can't see it. Can you see it? Can you see the fruit tree? They can't see it. So what are they going to do? They're going to pour poison on it and doubt and say, I don't see it. I don't know. Don't do it. Keep it, but just between you and God. Keep it. Don't lose it. Maybe at this point you can tell somebody, oh, I see it a little bit. Yeah, I can kind of see a fig tree. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, you might get there. What about here? Oh, man. You can't hide it anymore. It's going to start producing fruit. But you see, that woman knew, I've got to keep this. I can't tell anybody, because what would you tell a woman at 80-something years old if she told you she's pregnant? Oh, my God, what are the odds of you carrying that baby to full term? It's the truth. You think it's the truth. But she knew. She was a wise woman. So I'm encouraging you tonight. Whatever your need is, I'm out of time. I love you guys. I wish I could spend so long. I didn't even make it to the end of it. But I'm telling you, hopefully you understand, this is how it works. This is how you get your need met. There's no other way. There's no shortcut. And I need friends. I need people that are Miracle Grow friends. I need people that will get around me and pour Miracle Grow on me. I don't need no poison friends. And I think we're in a safe place. This is an excellent house to be in. We've got excellent pastors who do a good job of creating that environment. So I'm just thankful. I'm so blessed. And so I love you guys. I bless you. Let me close out in prayer, and I hope this blesses you. Father, thank you so much for your word tonight. Thank you for truth. Thank you for life. Thank you for loving us enough to tell us what we need to hear. God, I ask that you would bless this word, that it would go deep into the hearts of your children. God, help us to be faithful with the seed, that we would bring it to pass, God, that we would be true disciples of the Lord, that we would continue in your word, and that, God, we would produce great fruit for your kingdom. We love you, we bless you, we honor you, and we ask this in complete faith. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you guys. Hope you have a good night. See you Wednesday.
My head.